Thanks, Annette. Hi, everyone. My name is Kelly Head, and I'm a staff attorney here at ASISTA. I'm joined by my colleagues, Leah Ocasio, a staff attorney here at ASISTA, as well as Christina Velez, the legal and policy director here at ASISTA. Thank you for joining us for our OVW webinar on representing U visa clients with complex issues. We'd like to take this opportunity to thank OVW for their generous support of our training and technical assistance work. Without their support, today's webinar would not be possible. A few housekeeping items before we begin. ASISTA sent the slides and an index of materials to all attendees. As Annette said, this webinar is being recorded and the recording will be sent to attendees after the webinar. This webinar has been approved for 2 CLE credits in Texas. If you are barred in Texas and you would like CLE credit, you should have already put your bar number in your registration materials. But if you have not done so, you can email Maria Lazzarino, ASISTA's program associate, after the webinar. If you are not barred in Texas, but you would like to request CLE credit on your own behalf, please email Maria after the webinar to request a certificate of attendance. And as Annette said earlier, please make sure to put all of your questions in the Q&A box instead of the chat box to ensure that they will not get lost. We have reserved time for questions at the end of today's webinar. Next slide, please.
Oh, Kelly, who are you wanting to run the slides? Should I share my screen?
Yes, thank you.
Okay, here, 1 second.
Sorry about that. So if we go to slide number 2, please. Thank you. So for today's learning objectives, by participating in this webinar, you will be better able to first assess whether a U visa client has triggered a criminal ground of inadmissibility and whether an exception applies to inadmissibility. Number 2, to formulate stronger arguments for discretionary waivers that are available to you non-immigrants. Number 3, to apply a framework in discretionary cases for arguing that a client's mental health condition either mitigates or contextualizes negative factors. And finally, to understand the rights of non-citizens with significant mental health conditions and removal proceedings, including steps that practitioners can take if a client may be considered incompetent to proceed with the hearing. Next slide, please. So for today's webinar, we're going to start with a session on criminal grounds of inadmissibility, as well as waivers and discretion. We'll discuss the criminal and drug-related grounds of inadmissibility, as well as waivers and discretion. Then we will move on to mental health considerations, including how evidence of a client's mental health condition may mitigate or contextualize negative factors, as well as rights of non-citizens with significant mental health conditions in removal proceedings. And then we will finish with Q&A. Next slide, please. Okay, Leah, you can take it away.
Thanks, Kelly. So we're going to start with criminal grounds of inadmissibility. And next slide, please. And so we can find grounds of inadmissibility at INA 212A and criminal grounds at INA 212A2. So it's important to know, just starting out, that these grounds apply to those who are applying within the U.S., those who are applying to consular process to enter the U.S., and applies to both principal and derivative U petitioners. It's also important to note there is no blanket exception here for minor applicants, and so still need to evaluate potentially whether they are inadmissible under these or any other grounds. Another thing to highlight, and we will highlight this elsewhere as well, is that even if they've never been in the US, and this is usually true for derivatives abroad, it doesn't automatically mean that they are not inadmissible for triggering one of these grounds. And so also, this isn't an exclusive list of all the grounds or even all the criminal related grounds of inadmissibility. So we do recommend that you check the statute, but hopefully these frameworks help you assess for other grounds as well. We will be looking at crimes involving moral turpitude and controlled substances violations in particular. Next slide, please. So what are we keeping in mind when we're evaluating this? So first is to determine what grounds or which grounds require a conviction in order to be triggered. And we will also discuss what immigration law defines as a conviction. And then we'll also look at what grounds are triggered by an admission, and so that a conviction is not required. And we will also discuss what qualifies as an admission in order to trigger a ground of inadmissibility. And finally, which grounds are triggered even without a conviction or admission? Do want to flag here, we won't be getting very deep into the categorical approach today. That can be its own training or multiple trainings. So we will highlight broadly in some places where that approach might be helpful. And we will probably repeat several times where it's important to look at not only your state statutes, but circuit case law and other sources of law as you evaluate whether your client is inadmissible, since that might be necessary. What will also be important throughout is that when we're evaluating whether someone is inadmissible, that even where an exception doesn't apply, if someone isn't inadmissible, that there is some good faith argument that they are not inadmissible, that it's important not to concede inadmissibility and just skip to arguing for a waiver, even in the U context, which has a pretty broad waiver available. Still, we want to make sure we don't overlook any grounds because we want to make sure that if a ground has been triggered, it is disclosed so that USCIS can waive it. And so it'll be a proper grant of the U. Next slide, please. So this first ground we'll talk briefly is multiple criminal convictions. And so the site is there on the slide. Here, this is triggered where the individual has been convicted of at least two offenses, where the aggregate sentences to confinement were 5 or more years. Technically, an exception would be where they are purely political offenses. And there is a case in your materials, matter of O'Cally, apologies to the Irish for that pronunciation, I'm sure is wrong, where it's a BIA case that defines what is a purely political offense and lists three kinds. But the important thing to know is that they find it has to be a completely or totally political offense in order to qualify as a purely political offense in order to meet this exception. It's important to know too, it doesn't matter what the underlying offenses are. So the offenses that could trigger this might not trigger any other ground of inadmissibility. They might not be controlled substances offenses. They might not be crimes involving moral turpitude. But even if they came from the same incident, the same event, if that confinement aggregate adds up to at least 5 years, they have triggered this offense. Even if that sentence was suspended. And so this is why it would be very important to get documentation and information from a potential client to know whether they have triggered this and not just rely on their memory, because this one, courts often say a lot of things about conviction or sentencing that might be true for criminal law, but unfortunately not true for immigration purposes. And so it'd be really important to know whether they've triggered this ground, even if somehow they haven't triggered any other. And so moving on to the next slide, I'll pass it to Christina to talk about crimes involving moral turpitude.
Thanks, Leah. Hi, everyone. So we are going to get in this presentation, we're going to get more into detail about CIMTs and controlled substance violations, but they are not the, as Leah said just now, they're not the sort of the full like scope of criminal grounds of inadmissibility that might apply to your clients. Nevertheless, CIMT is a pretty large category that affects a lot of people who are applying for survivor-based relief, as we've seen in our TAs. So we wanted to get a little bit more into it with y'all. As far as what is a CIMT, a crime involving moral turpitude, it's a very antiquated term. It's a term that has vexed many practitioners and courts and federal courts over the years. It's been called a term that has been called nebulous, stale, antiquated. Judge Posner in the Seventh Circuit called it an embarrassment to the modern legal system. But nevertheless, you know, the Supreme Court held in 1951 in Jordan v. DeGeorge that it was not void for vagueness. So it was not unconstitutionally void. And so we are living with it. We have been living with it ever since. As far as what it means, there's no statutory definition in the INA. The definition on the slide has the generally agreed upon meaning. CIMT has been interpreted judicially in case law, mostly in the removal context and in appeals to the BIA and the circuit courts, which as you can see, well, I think on the next slide, we show that those determinations apply equally to USCIS. CIMT has generally been deemed to include offenses that fall into certain categories that contain an element of depravity that injures or offends the community. This typically includes offenses such as fraud and those that result in physical harm. Can also change with the times, as the BIA has noted that the so-called rules of morality change in accordance to the prevailing views in society, although immigration law can be slow to catch up. So CIMT also, one thing too that I really want to make clear here, and I think most of you already know this, but for those of you who do not, CIMT does not correspond easily to the felony slash misdemeanor distinction. There are a couple of broad rules, and also as Leah mentioned, the analysis used to determine whether a particular criminal offense, a conviction under state law comprises, or even an admission to an offense under state law is deemed a crime involving moral turpitude. The analysis used to get to that answer is called the categorical approach. It involves comparing generic definitions to the definitions of a crime under state law, and is sort of beyond the scope of our presentation today, but we can cover some of the sort of like general categories that have emerged over time as in case law and talk about some of the threshold questions that also come up. CIMT, one last thing I'll say, CIMT generally have a mens rea requirement and also this sort of inchoate immoral morality element to them. So they require both reprehensible conduct and a culpable mental state. The minimum mens rea defined in the statute for a conviction to result is recklessness. That's the immigration statute. Negligence crimes are not considered CIMTs. Typically, crimes of criminal negligence and strict liability crimes are not found to be CIMTs, even if they result in serious harm or injury or even death, such as negligent homicide. There is, of course, variation in interpretation of CIMTs across the federal circuit courts. So again, it's very important to check the applicable case law when you have a question about whether your client's conviction could fall into this category. So even some offenses, though, you know, everything has a little bit of an exception in immigration law. So even some offenses that are strict liability, like statutory rape, might still be deemed to be CIMTs. Again, the analysis is highly specific to the language of the criminal statute defining the offense and the range of conduct that can be punished under the particular statute underlying a conviction. But generally speaking, where a criminal statute punishes both negligence and recklessness or intent-based crimes, they need to be analyzed for the least culpable conduct that can result in a conviction. Finally, I'll note that the ground of inadmissibility can be triggered by either a conviction or an admission. And we're gonna talk a little bit about what is required for an admission to trigger inadmissibility. Next slide, please. Thanks. Okay, so For a conviction to trigger inadmissibility for CIMT, it needs to meet these requirements on the slide. This is covered in INA 101A and 48A, and also in case law, of course. Keep in mind that other grounds of inadmissibility don't require a conviction either, even if there's no admission of guilt. For example, I'm thinking of the ground of inadmissibility that may come into play if DHS concludes that there is reason to believe a non-citizen has engaged in drug trafficking. But this is the framework for CIMT admissibility and also controlled substance violation inadmissibility, which I think Leo will get to soon. So to find a conviction under the immigration law, there either has to be a formal judgment of guilt entered by the court or some kind of plea or verdict and a judicially ordered punishment or limitation on liberty. This includes suspended sentences, as Leah mentioned, and also deferred adjudications, such as when someone pleads guilty and attends a drug rehab program, after which their conviction is expunged. Those are still convictions for immigration law purposes. So it's very important to note that although those types of convictions that result from deferred processes, deferred adjudications rather, may not cause harmful consequences for a person in other areas of life, and under the immigration law, they are still considered to be convictions. We'll get more into that, I think, on the next slide. But first, I wanted to cover some of these requirements for making an admission. These requirements are laid out in the cases that are cited here, and I think also in your materials. The conduct being admitted to must be a crime in the jurisdiction. The admission must constitute all of the essential elements of the crime as defined by the statute. The non-citizen must have been provided with a definition of the offense in understandable terms, and the admission must be free and voluntary. So it's very difficult actually to make an admission that is sufficient to meet all of these requirements and to trigger inadmissibility. As your client will need to have been informed of the elements of the offense in such a way that they understand themselves to be making an admission of guilt. But it's still important to know this for various reasons, but including that DHS officers are not above trying to elicit these admissions in during questioning at ports of entry, at the border, during USCIS interviews, or in immigration court during cross-examination, because immigration officers are empowered to inquire into the circumstances underlying any arrests that the person may have. They can and do sometimes, ask these additional questions that seem geared towards finding an admission. So keep those things in mind as well. But again, it's very difficult to meet these requirements in, say, an affidavit supporting a petition for U visa relief. But it's not impossible. It's just very difficult. Okay, let's go to the next slide. Okay, so more about what is a conviction and what isn't. Again, this is because the immigration law defines convictions very broadly, more so than maybe other sort of areas of civil consequence. Comparing the two columns here, we can talk about some of that. A juvenile court disposition is not considered a conviction under the immigration law. It's better thought of as a non-criminal court adjudication rather than a conviction. A juvenile, however, someone I guess under the age of 18, I believe, who is convicted as an adult in adult criminal court does, however, have a conviction for immigration purposes, subject to an exception that we'll talk about in a second. decision or ruling of nolle prosequi means generally that the DA has declined to prosecute the offense. Depending on the state and the local system where you work, you might not be able to get a formal disposition of an arrest from a court where this has happened, but you can usually obtain a letter from the court or maybe from the DA that confirms that the charges were dropped. And that will be also, should also be reflected on any background checks. This is different, again, from a diversion program, as reflected in the other column, and as I talked about on the last slide. You really can't unring that bell, unfortunately. And so an alternative that's usually adopted by immigration practitioners who have clients in, who have clients in criminal proceedings, when they're able to advise their criminal defense attorneys, and nowadays, of course, many criminal defense attorneys understand this, an alternative is to obtain a very, like a very long continuance before any kind of guilty plea is made or any kind of finding of guilt is made, during which, if the person stays out of contact with law enforcement, the charges may then be dismissed. So it kind of, yes, exactly. Oh, great. Thank you, Barbara, for noting that. And what was I saying here? Okay, I should not look at the chat. So diversion programs are usually like a big no-no as far as whether they are safe for immigrants. So keep that in mind. To finish my thought before, the alternative option in New York City is usually called an adjournment in contemplation of dismissal. After 6 months or a year, if there are no additional police contacts, the case is usually automatically dismissed. Some jurisdictions do not automatically dismiss charges after this period of time has passed. And so it's, again, very important to understand what's going on in your state law in order to make the best decisions for your client. Sometimes there needs to be an additional filing after that period has run that will cause the charges to be dismissed. All right. Another thing, a vacated judgment. Those are more complicated. They are actually, very much a contested area of immigration law currently. Back in 2003, the BIA came out with a decision called Matter of Pickering that set forth some of the rules for determining whether a vacated judgment has effect for immigration purposes, meaning whether a vacated judgment eliminates the conviction and the consequences that flow from that conviction. So generally speaking, if the court record establishes that the court vacated the judgment for a procedural or substantive defect, it should be effective. Those kinds of defects are, I think a lot of times before it was common and required actually to advise immigrants of the immigration consequences of convictions. It was very common for them to not understand that when they agreed to guilty pleas. And so that's very often now considered to be a procedural defect that's used to obtain post-conviction relief. Vacated and expunged judgments related to rehabilitation or to specifically to avoid adverse immigration consequences are typically not accepted as effective to eliminate convictions under the immigration law. And those are becoming very common also as we're seeing changes to the marijuana laws across the United States. So it's just important to keep in mind that even though a judgment might be expunged for all other purposes, it may not be for immigration purposes. Okay. Next slide. Thank you. And then I think I turn it over. Yes. Okay. So there are two statutory exceptions to CIMT that are pretty useful to know about. If a client has only one conviction and it triggers the CIMT ground but falls into one of these exceptions, the ground just simply does not apply. It's not actually a ground of inadmissibility at all. And if there are no other grounds of inadmissibility present, you may not actually need to file a waiver at all. So these are very useful. The first exception on the slide to the left is the youthful offender exception that I hinted at earlier. For an offender who is under 18 when the crime is committed but convicted in adult court, remember a juvenile disposition is not a conviction at all. For a person who is convicted for an offense that took place before they turned 18, this exception allows them to apply for a visa or other admission to the U.S. if more than 5 years have passed from the date of their release from confinement. So if they were convicted, 5 years ago, but they served 30 days, the key date is 5 years plus 30 days. This is an exception to the CIMT ground, not to criminal inadmissibility as a whole. So an adjudicator could conceivably find that another ground applies, even if not a CIMT. Different grounds may also have different exceptions, but the YO exception is important to know about for CIMTs. Second, the petty offense exception is possibly the most useful exception to inadmissibility in a lot of the cases that we see, because so many low-level offenses that might be considered CIMTs fall into this exception. And it's often not picked up by practitioners or USCIS and only comes up with the AAO when they realize that actually this exception applies. So the exception applies if the maximum penalty under the criminal code or statute cannot exceed 1 year, that's 365 days, and the non-citizen actually served less than 6 months. Even if they were issued a suspended sentence for a longer period of time. This provision specifies actual confinement, an actual period of confinement. Other sections of the immigration law that apply to criminal inadmissibility speak to sentences and not actual terms of imprisonment. Okay. So again, this is important. Oh, so this exception functions a little bit differently if the person has multiple convictions for the same or similar kinds of offenses. So if someone has multiple shoplifting convictions, for example, that fall into the CIMT category in their jurisdiction, although the ground is triggered, So if someone has one shoplifting offense, it may fall into this petty offense exception. If someone has two shoplifting offenses, the ground is triggered, but it's the second offense that makes them inadmissible, and they become inadmissible as of the commission of the second offense. So the petty exception still applies somewhat. It may be helpful for them when the date of inadmissibility matters for eligibility for relief, such as for cancellation of removal. And so you should not sleep on that if you have a client who's in removal proceedings who might otherwise be eligible for cancellation, but they have these multiple CIMTs present. Okay. Now I think we are going to turn it over to Leah for controlled substance violation.
Drug conversation. Yes. Thanks, Christina. Next slide, please. We'll be talking about drug-related inadmissibility grounds. We won't get into the drug abuser addict grounds that are listed on the slide, but we have included some materials on that for your review that gets into the definitions of drug abuse and addiction and when those grounds might be triggered or not. And today we'll be focused more on controlled substance violations and trafficking. Next slide, please. So what is a controlled substance violation? So as always, we start with the law. And so the INA defines it as a conviction or admission to the elements of a violation of any law or regulation relating to a controlled substance. So right away, we note that a conviction is not all that's required if there's a qualifying admission. And that framework, as Christina laid out, for CIMTs is the framework to use to evaluate whether someone's made a qualifying admission for purposes of this ground as well. it also says any law or regulation, and they mean that. So that can be within the US or abroad. And this is why we say someone who maybe has never set foot in the US or is applying from abroad or waiting abroad could still trigger this ground, even where they haven't violated a US law based on a controlled substance violation. And so this is important to keep in mind to get that information from those abroad to make sure that there isn't that, that they haven't triggered this ground. Even where there is a conviction or, you know, criminal statute involved that relates to controlled substance violations, it's important to see whether there's an argument that it still didn't trigger this ground. And so again, here's where we flag a categorical approach may be necessary. We're going to be a bit surface level here, but there may be arguments that the state or, you know, whatever statute they were convicted under is broader than the federal statute. So there we look at the site on the screen, 21 CFR 1308 is the federal controlled substance schedules. And oftentimes state statutes will have schedules that include substances that are not in the federal schedule. And so if it does that, where it has those named beyond what's included federally, there can be an argument that the state statute is overbroad and therefore this law or this ground hasn't been triggered by that conviction. This is where it's important to check your circuit law to see how your circuit treats overbreath and also what might be required to show that beyond just the statutory language, because some do require additional steps or there are arguments either way to avoid those extra steps in certain circuits. So we do recommend checking that, and also feel free to schedule TA with us if that seems to be an issue in your case. Next slide, please. So what are we talking about with controlled substance violations? So there are some examples on your screen, possession of a controlled substance or drug paraphernalia or being under the influence. It's important to know that where there are convictions for these offenses, they could also trigger other grounds of inadmissibility. For example, possession with intent to sell could trigger the controlled substance violation as well as a CIMT. And so it's important to do that evaluation to know whether more than one ground of inadmissibility has been triggered, even with, you know, the one action or one conviction. A reminder, when we say any law or regulation, for those that are in states that have legalized marijuana, federally speaking, it is still a controlled substance, and it's still a federal offense to even possess marijuana. And so this does include convictions or admissions relating to the use or possession of legalized marijuana. And so that's something to keep in mind when working with clients or as clients are in states that have legalized marijuana, one of those instances where state law and federal law do not align and immigration law follows the federal law. There is a discretionary waiver at 212H related to one offense of simple possession of 30 grams or less of marijuana that might be helpful for certain forms of relief, but we will also discuss the waivers shortly that are specific to you petitioners. Next slide, please. Controlled substance trafficking. Next slide, please. So here there's a distinction from controlled substance violation. I think wherever there is an issue of controlled substances, you want to do this evaluation to make sure these grounds haven't been triggered, even where there is no conviction, because as we learned with controlled substance violation, a conviction isn't required. And as we'll see with the language here, a conviction is not required for this trafficking ground, and it's much broader than even an admission. So the language is for a non-citizen where immigration officials know or have reason to believe that they were trafficking a controlled substance or the spouse of a child of a trafficker and received a benefit from that in the last 5 years. So before diving into that language, I do want to highlight, in case it helps, I don't know how often it comes up, the actual statutory language, which we recommend everyone look at first, for that second clause of being a family member, a spouse or child of a trafficker, does say a non-citizen, well, obviously uses the language alien, but a non-citizen trafficker of controlled substances, such that if somebody was married to a US citizen who was drug trafficking and could meet these other elements that they knew or should have known that the benefits they were receiving were related to the trafficking, the plain language of the statute does not say, you know, it's triggered by being married or related to a US citizen who's trafficking. So just want to flag that, just look at the plain language of the statute there. The statute also has pretty broad language though of those who have trafficked, also includes those who aided, abetted, conspired, or colluded, and knowingly did so. And because a conviction or admission is not required, that is pulled from this reason to believe language, which is very broad, but it's important to note this is the government's reason to believe. And so you might review and have suspicions, but I don't think it would be necessary to say, well, we think they might have triggered this. We're going to disclose all the bad details to get it waived potentially. The government is the one that has to have reason to believe someone has triggered this ground. And it has to be more than just a suspicion. So the government is the one that has to support this charge or this allegation with substantial and probative evidence that the individual was or is engaged in trafficking controlled substances. And so if they raise it, you can and should argue against this, but know that this is their reason to believe, not yours or your client's. So what is involved here? Credibility will be a big issue. I think that's throughout with most any form of relief that you're asking for. But because this doesn't require admission or conviction, this reason to believe doesn't have to rise to that level either. So the government, in providing this probative evidence, has to be credible as well. And the client arguing that they are not inadmissible under this ground, depending on what evidence they have, I mean, that evidence certainly has to be credible, but depending on the evidence that they are combating, that the government has shown, they will have to be credible too, which may be more difficult depending on the evidence the government has to support this claim. And there's a lot of case law, BIA cases in your materials where you'll see where the court is saying, well, you didn't rebut any of this evidence. There was substantial evidence that the government's providing. You know, none of the officers that were saying what happened seemed not credible, and didn't attack their credibility, you know, throughout the case. And so you'll see what they look at in terms of this credibility. Other arguments too, is again, when we're talking controlled substance, that is federally defined. And so it seems minor, but perhaps the substance they had is not defined as a controlled substance. Like, it is beyond that. And so that's one level. But another level, trafficking is a commercial act. And so here there can be an argument that whether they possessed a controlled substance, it was not with the intent to traffic, i.e. to sell or to distribute it. And so here might be where credibility becomes very important too, to say, you know, so that they can be believable when they say that it was, for example, for personal use, which should not trigger the trafficking ground. Could be an issue otherwise, but at least for this reason to believe should not be sufficient. Similarly, the examples we listed for controlled substance violations, like simple possession of a substance or the paraphernalia, should not be enough to trigger this reason to believe ground either. The government has to show more than that. Where there is a conviction though, again, there's, you know, analyses to do, not only to determine whether that conviction is sufficient or if there's any sort of relief possible, legal defect, there are other ways to attack a conviction, but also to look at that because a conviction for trafficking of controlled substances can also be an aggravated felony, which for other forms of relief can be an absolute bar to obtaining that relief. And can also trigger the CIMT ground of inadmissibility. But remember, a conviction isn't required. It'll just be that much harder potentially to overcome. this is a conduct-based ground. And so here we want to flag where we mentioned a juvenile disposition isn't a conviction for immigration purposes. The government could try to use that disposition as a basis for this reason to believe. There could be arguments against that. I don't know how strong that would be to say that, a disposition for a juvenile, isn't a crime. It was juvenile delinquency. And here we're talking about illicit or criminal activity. If you've made such an argument and been successful, we'd love to hear. But I think it would be a much more uphill battle because they're not talking about conviction at that point. They're looking at any evidence they can provide to say someone has triggered this ground. Next slide, please. And this is just an overview chart of the different grounds that we discussed, including drug abuser, addict, how they're triggered, and the exceptions. Remember, if an exception exists or applies to the applicant, the waiver is not necessary unless, as Christina highlighted, there's a second petty offense, for example, where they would still be inadmissible for a CIMT for that second offense. And so another thing to highlight that we're going to discuss waivers in just a moment, but it's important to know that even if past actions by a client don't rise to the level of triggering a ground of inadmissibility, where the record reflects activity related to drugs, including controlled substance violations, USCIS can and often does look at that and weigh it very heavily as a negative discretionary factor, even where it's not an inadmissibility. And so the more negative factors or the more serious the inadmissibility, the more will be needed to demonstrate why they should grant the waiver. As you can see in this chart, all of these grounds can be waived through the U, but just because USCIS can waive them does not mean that they will because this is discretionary. And so they do not have to. And next slide, please. So what are we looking at to try to waive these grounds? So first is knowing what might be an issue in the case. And I'm sure many of you have perfected and tweaked your intake questions because we've all had that one client that we get surprised, just blindsided by a list of criminal offenses or an RFE listing things we had no idea was in their record. And so here, too, part of the issue is, again, courts will, or attorneys, defense attorneys, especially pre-Padilla, will say, you don't have to worry about a case or you don't have a conviction for any purpose. And logic would dictate that they don't have a conviction for any purpose. And so they won't think that they have to disclose it to you or to USCIS because they don't have a conviction. It's gone. And we know as attorneys that that's not true for immigration. And so oftentimes it's not just asking, were they arrested, but asking about any and all contact with police or if they've ever been put in handcuffs or spent a night in jail. Instead of just asking if they were charged or convicted of a crime, asking if they ever had to go to court and what happened, and not just relying on their memory. If you have other examples of questions that you've changed to try to get this information more accurately from clients, please share, because we know clients, they're getting different information from the court itself, and also memories aren't the strongest. And so another thing is to obtain the copy of the records, not relying solely on their memory of events or their understanding of what happened, especially with older cases. I know many already as a standard do FBI background checks or certain FOIAs for their potential clients just to try to get ahead of any possible issues that could come up later. Want to flag FBI background checks might not contain everything, thinking of like smaller towns or counties or older cases that aren't digitized. Those things can be harder to find and needing to know what those effects are. With all that information, want to evaluate whether they've actually triggered a ground of inadmissibility. Remember, if an exception applies, the waiver is not needed. Also, if there's a good faith argument that they haven't triggered a ground, then it's not necessary to concede it. So where there are no grounds of inadmissibility at all, the U visa is not a discretionary decision if they meet the other elements. It becomes discretionary when USCIS is evaluating whether to grant the 192. So even if someone their only inadmissibility is being present without admission or parole, it's now a discretionary decision whether USCIS wants to grant that waiver. And so here's where it's important too to keep in mind, there's a difference between the inadmissibility grounds and negative discretionary factors. Inadmissibility grounds oftentimes are negative discretionary factors, but the reverse isn't always true. So where a petitioner has had criminal contact, that'll often be disclosed. The forms ask for that information, but it might not rise to a ground of inadmissibility, though you may have to present that argument for USCIS because they can and do get those evaluations wrong. But just because it's not an inadmissibility does not mean USCIS won't factor that into their decision. So even if it's not a ground of inadmissibility, they will say, well, and I'm sure we've all seen those decisions that say, well, you have multiple tickets for driving without a license. And those didn't rise to the level of inadmissibility, but now they're combining that with any grounds of inadmissibility to say, well, here's a pattern of disregard for law, or here we're seeing this issue. And so these negatives now outweigh any positives. And so it'll be really important that as the negatives are there, that you're outweighing them with positive factors and evidence. Next slide, please. So here are the waiver provisions available to the U petitioners. And so one at D212 D14 and the other at D3. D14 is the U specific waiver versus D3, which is just a general non-immigrant waiver. And since U's are non-immigrant petitioners, they can utilize that waiver as well. DHS is the only one who can adjudicate the D14 waiver. And as you can see, it's very broad. The only thing it doesn't waive is, you know, Nazi persecution, torture, genocide, and the like. It has to be, the evaluation is whether it's in the national or public interest to grant, which USCIS has not defined. Oftentimes what we'll see is 192 denials that will say this D14 waiver hasn't been tested before appellate authorities, but it's reasonable to at least apply the criteria of a D3 waiver. And so if you haven't done that, you necessarily haven't satisfied the D14 waiver. So it essentially treats this D14 waiver as a subset of the D3 waiver, which, as you can tell, is not how it's set up. And so be prepared to make your arguments under both waivers and explicitly like this national or public interest. And I believe the T visa language actually has more information about that. And it's for T's, but can be some guiding language for an argument for a U waiver. I also want to highlight that regulation there on the chart. Where there are criminal grounds of inadmissibility, if they're particularly violent or dangerous, I would say even numerous, you'll see USCIS will only exercise favorable discretion in extraordinary circumstances. So you may have to really outweigh with positive factors or explain those inadmissibility grounds, which we'll discuss shortly. The D3 waiver, is available to use. I will say in some jurisdictions, it's possible to file this before the court. And so I think that's in the 4th, 7th, and 11th circuits. They have jurisdiction over D3 waivers for you petitioners. And so that's something to consider because sometimes the courts may grant something USCIS would not. And again, this is a pretty broad waiver, but you'll see it has more exceptions than the D14 waiver does. And Matter of Franca, which is in your materials, does lay out those factors, which include the seriousness of the violations, the risk of the harm, and say what the adjudicator is supposed to be reviewing and evaluating for purposes of determining whether someone should get this D3 waiver. Next slide, please. So how do you make the argument for this waiver? So we want to show USCIS that the petitioner isn't a risk to the US, but rather an asset to have. And that'll be when USCIS is more likely to grant the waiver. And so where there are these inadmissibility grounds or negative factors that have to be addressed, there are these three R's on the screen of expressing remorse, taking responsibility, and showing habilitation. here you want to be specific. So not only that they're not going to repeat those errors or have completed any sentence or probation, but what are they specifically doing? Like positive activities, contributions, connections to the community that you can demonstrate through evidence. Passage of time from the last conviction per se can be helpful, but note USCIS will still evaluate everything. And so there are times they will deny and say, even where there's been a long time that's passed between the last conviction and the 192 adjudication, the severity of the offenses outweigh the positives. And so don't rely just on the passage of time, though it is good to highlight where there has been significant period of time since the last offense. It also is helpful to connect it to the victimization on which the U visa is based. So for example, say there's multiple shoplifting offenses that now you do have multiple CIMTs. Were they forced to shoplift because their abuser forced them to or wouldn't feed them and they had to feed themselves and their child with no money? Are there ways to connect that to pull at heartstrings and make that connection so USCIS is more likely to grant? And finally, this national public interest. So again, the policy manual language for T visas discusses national interest. For the T visa provision. And so that framework can be helpful for U visas. And so here it's not just their cooperation, but family unity, risk of harm if they were returned to home country. Just really putting that in there to show this national public interest language for the D14 waiver. And so with that, I think we have a poll separately before I pass it to Kelly to discuss mental health. Next slide.
Should I? Thanks, Leah. So we have a poll just to give everybody a little bit of a break from CIMTs and the like. We're wondering if anybody would like ACISA's OVW webinar slides, OVW handouts, and other OVW materials to be accessible in other languages. And if yes, please put in the chat box which languages you're interested in. Give folks another minute to answer. Okay, I'm seeing Spanish. Okay, I'm seeing Chinese, Korean, Vietnamese, Portuguese.
Tui and Akan and another one for Vietnamese. Does anyone think they should be available in Haitian Creole or French?
Yes, we have a yes for Haitian Creole. I think Arabic, French, okay. Haitian Creole, yep.
I just want to make sure we're not leaving. Urdu.
Urdu. Okay.
Bengali, maybe. I'm just naming languages that I've had clients who speak.
Right. Bengali. Yep. Mm-hmm. Thanks, Christina. Russian. Tagalog. Pashto, Georgian, Turkish.
We're getting all of them now.
All the languages. Bulgarian.
Interesting.
Okay.
English, Mongolian. Fine. Thanks, everyone. Mom, okay. Yes. That's a good one. Yes.
Mongolian. Okay.
Well, thank you, everybody, for those answers. I do see the overwhelming majority is yes. So that's very helpful information for us. Thank you. Okay. So next slide, please. So thank you, Leah, for that, and Christina, for that really great presentation. We're going to move on now to mental health issues and how they may mitigate or contextualize otherwise negative factors. And just for framing purposes, we want to clarify that mental health issues, you know, by themselves are not always a negative factor. And even though inadmissibility for mental health issues isn't the topic of today's presentation, they're also not always a ground of inadmissibility. The mental health ground of inadmissibility, which is that INA 212A requires a mental disorder and some sort of associated behavior. So just keep that in mind, that the existence of the mental health disorder itself shouldn't be a ground of inadmissibility alone. Today, we're going to be largely focusing on how mental health can factor into that discretionary analysis that Leah was talking about earlier. Next slide, please. So discretion is a consideration, like Leah was talking about, in a lot of U visa contexts. Some of those examples are listed on your screen here. Some important considerations when you're thinking about discretion is that the burden is on the client to show that a favorable exercise of discretion is warranted, and that if there are serious adverse factors, like Leah was talking about, in both the U inadmissibility waiver as well as the U adjustment contexts, you may need to present evidence of extraordinary positive equities, and at least in the adjustment concept context, extreme and exceptional hardship before USCIS will exercise discretion favorably in your case. Next slide, please. So when you're trying to mitigate or contextualize negative factors with mental health evidence, make sure to use that balancing test that Leah was talking about in your favor. The fact that discretionary analysis is a balancing test gives you this really great opportunity to bring in all of these positive equities that you can use to show that your client is deserving of staying in the United States. And this is the place where you can be creative and to work with your client to show to bring in that positive evidence. So make sure you're using that balancing test to your favor. And because discretion, the burden is on the client, make sure that you are getting all of those positive equities into the record. You can argue that mental health conditions are a mitigating factor. There are a bunch of AAO non-precedent decisions in your materials that touch on mental health. And while a lot of them, the ultimate result was not positive, they do have some helpful tidbits in there. There have been multiple decisions where they've held that the existence of a mental health condition is a positive or mitigating factor in the discretionary analysis. So you can make that argument. There was also a decision where they specifically held that an applicant whose quote unquote negative behavior that was related to trauma, they considered that to be a favorable factor. So if you can tie the alleged negative behavior to, for example, the client's victimization or trauma, like Leah was talking about, that is something you can also consider in the analysis. And we would recommend citing the portions of those decisions in your briefs and perhaps attaching them to your submission. Next slide, please. So we recommend a two-pronged approach to using mental health evidence to help mitigate negative factors. Based on at least what I've seen from the AAO decisions, it may not be very effective to just argue that there's a connection between the client's mental health condition and the negative factor, because the USCIS and the AAO want to see those three R's that Leah was just talking about. So the ideal approach is to both make that clear showing of the connection between the mental health ground and the negative factor, but also bring in all of the evidence that shows that the client has taken responsibility for their behavior, has expressed remorse, and has shown rehabilitation. Again, the connection alone, even if it's very compelling, may not be enough. The AAO has denied cases even when there was a connection between the negative factors and the client's mental health condition. Next slide, please. So the first part of this approach is to show this connection between the negative factor. That could be a substance abuse issue, it could be a criminal history, between the client's mental health condition and that negative factor. And the ideal approach is to do this in multiple ways. The most important is the client's statement. It's ideal that if the client is able to do so, that in their statement, they acknowledge their mental health condition. Some other important aspects to keep in mind for a client's statement is all of this being in the client's own words, their explanation of their symptoms and how they affect them on a daily basis. So for clients who have, for example, PTSD, an explanation of in their client's own words, how they perceive their symptoms and how they perceive those symptoms as affecting them. An explanation from the client of their negative factors. A recurring theme, especially with the AAO, is that they want clients to explain the circumstances of arrests. So it's important that the client does this in their own words, but to make sure you're being careful of admissions. Like Christina was saying, it's unlikely that a client would make it difficult to make an admission, but just keep that in mind when the client is explaining the circumstances of the arrests. To the extent the client is able to perceive it, an explanation in their own words of any sort of connection between the mental health condition and the qualifying crime, because like the presenters earlier were talking about, that can help tug on the heartstrings and make the client appear more sympathetic. So for example, if the client, you know, understands that they have flashbacks of abuse, if they feel like, you know, they have to be constantly looking over their shoulder, constantly on guard, and they've been, you know, diagnosed with PTSD, the client is able to express that they have these symptoms and that these symptoms only started after the abuse. You know, that is an example of the client expressing that connection between the qualifying crime and the mental health symptoms. And then similarly, if the client is able to perceive this, is it helpful in their statement for them to describe any sort of connection between the mental health condition that they have and negative factors? Like for example, if the client understands that because of the abuse that they've suffered, they have symptoms of depression, and that in the past, they were unable to access therapy, so they numbed their symptoms with alcohol. If they're able to recognize that and, you know, in their own words, explain that in their statement, that also helps connect the negative history, the negative factor with the mental health condition. And it's helpful for the client to have that out there in evidence rather than just the attorney mentioning it in the brief, because practitioner statements aren't considered evidence. If the client is being treated by a provider or was previously in treatment, it's really helpful to have a statement from the provider that touches on the factors that are listed on your screen here, as well as if possible, letters of support from friends and family. And then in all of this, the attorney's role is making the arguments and the advocacy that the client's trauma and mental health concerns should mitigate their negative factors, since the reason for the client's behavior, which in many cases will be a mental health condition, is relevant to the considerations that Leah was talking about, whether they're a public safety risk and whether their presence in the US is justified on humanitarian grounds, which is a consideration for adjustment, U adjustment cases, or whether it's in the national or public interest for U inadmissibility waivers. Next slide, please. And then the second prong, which may be the most important, is making sure that the client has, to the extent that they can, expressing genuine responsibility, remorse, and rehabilitation. And the best place for the client to do this, of course, is in their statement. The client should acknowledge their own role whenever possible in the conduct, in the behavior, without placing blame on other people. That is so, even if their mental health condition is related to the qualifying crime, USCIS really does want the client to take responsibility for their role in the behavior. It's important for the client to show remorse and to indicate any lessons they have learned. This can include a discussion of the changes the client has made in their life since the previous negative incident, that to ensure that this will not happen again. When you're talking to your client, you can talk to them about what have they learned from this incident and how will they use these lessons to change their behavior in the future, because this goes to what USCIS is interested in, whether the person is going to be a public safety risk whether they're going or whether they're going to change their behavior, whether they've been rehabilitated. And to the extent the client can explain lessons that they've learned from their past, that will be very helpful in that analysis. A very detailed description of their treatment and rehabilitative efforts is important, as well as acknowledgement of missteps. And what I mean by this is, for example, if the client has either multiple convictions, and especially multiple convictions for the same crime, like multiple DUIs, or if they say had a substance abuse problem and they were previously in recovery and relapsed, USCIS wants the client to acknowledge that. And the client needs to be convincing USCIS, why is this moment different? You know, if the client has relapsed in the past, why now? What makes this moment different? Why are they now committed to rehabilitation? Does it have to do with their children? Does it have to do with their job? Similarly with criminal convictions, what has the client learned? What has the client done that makes it so USCIS can trust that they will not engage in criminal activity in the future? And receipt of mental health treatment or mental health issues that cause the criminal activity is very compelling evidence that that is why now USCIS should believe that the client will not continue with that behavior. And then letters of support from the client's treatment providers, as well as their friends and family, can also be very helpful here. And like Leah was talking about before, the converse of the acknowledgement of missteps is that if it's true, if the client has had a significant amount of time without any missteps, without any further issues with, for example, the criminal legal system, that's important to highlight as well. Next slide, please. It's very important to have evidence of treatment if the client has been in treatment, because being in treatment shows that the client is committed to managing to their condition. And that goes to the desirability of the client's presence in the United States and their low risk to public safety, because they are now committed to managing the condition that had caused their previous behavior that USCIS has perceived as negative. And then you can argue that the client's treatment and their dedication to managing their condition is itself a positive factor and an indicator of rehabilitation. And the AAO has characterized receipt of treatment as a positive factor, most recently in April of this year. So there is, it's not precedent decision, but there is authority that you can cite for this proposition. The client's statement should address why they decided to receive treatment and any coping skills that they have learned from treatment that have led or will lead to behavior change, because again, that goes to convincing USCIS that this client has been rehabilitated and will not continue with the behavior that they have perceived as negative, because that is really important to USCIS. Focus on submitting, when you're talking about treatment, evidence of the client's participation in treatment and programs that they're not required to attend by court order. So say, you know, sometimes if someone gets a DUI, they might be required to attend AA meetings as part of their probation. The client is attending meetings that they're not required to attend, they're just attending AA meetings outside of a court mandate. That's very important to highlight, because that really highlights the fact that the client is dedicated to changing their behavior. And that again goes to rehabilitation, which is really one of the overall overarching themes that USCIS focuses on. When we're talking about treatment, the elephant in the room, of course, is access to treatment. Non-citizens, and particularly non-citizens without immigration status, often have difficulty accessing mental health treatment. There's, you know, I'm sure you all know, there's many reasons for that. Lack of insurance, cost barriers, cultural competency issues, language access issues, geographic isolation in some cases. So some strategies for considering how a client can access treatment, you can think about crime victim compensation, state and local assistance, nonprofits that provide counseling, as well as telemedicine for clients who, for example, are in rural areas and are unable to travel to access treatment but do have access to technology. Federally qualified health centers often do take patients who do not have insurance, and sometimes they do offer behavioral and mental health care services. There's a link in your slide here that you can click on, and then you would type the client's zip code in, and then you could see access to health centers that are nearby. That said, in more rural areas, qualified health centers might be few and far between. So given that, there are some circumstances where the client just simply cannot receive treatment. And in that case, it's important to explain, again, in the form of evidence, ideally in a statement from a client that's submitted to the USCIS of the client's efforts to receive treatment. And that shows that the client is, again, committed to taking the steps necessary to change their behavior and that they have actually taken the steps. And if the client is not receiving formalized mental health treatment for one of the reasons that we talked about, it's still worth this exploring with your client and including in their statement if they're doing anything else to overcome their mental health concerns. Are they working with friends and family members? Do they have a support group? Are they working with a case manager for clients who are religious? Are they working with a religious figure in their congregation or faith community? Are they working with peer counselors? Are they attending meetings? Anything that the client can submit to show that they are dedicated to changing their behavior and that they're working on changing their behavior despite the fact that they can't access treatment, that goes a long way to showing that the client is committed to rehabilitation. And then as the attorney, it's important to argue that a client who is unable to access treatment for reasons that are outside of their control, this should not prevent a client from obtaining an immigration status that Congress has designed to be remedial, has designed to be humanitarian in nature, that treatment access issues should not prevent the client from accessing the status, and to so hold would be contrary to the congressional intent of these types of immigration statuses. Next slide, please. Having a support system is very important for clients who have had mental health concerns. The AAO has held that without evidence of a support system and a plan for managing a non-citizen's mental health condition, that they can't conclude that the applicant does not pose a threat to public safety. So again, this was a non-precedent decision, but this is an expression of how the AAO feels about this topic. So it's important to the extent possible, if the client is able to demonstrate that they do have a support system of people in place, ideally including a mental health treatment provider who are helping them manage their condition, and that this the answers to these questions are addressed in submissions to USCIS. Next slide, please. So letters of support, the advice here about these letters, it applies to letters from both treatment providers as well as lay friends and family members. So letters of support are very common, especially in cases where a client may have negative discretionary factors, but they can be very compelling in showing that the client, that USCIS should exercise favorable discretion in the client's case. That said, there are some important factors to think about when talking about letters of support. So it is a recurring theme with the AAO that they're concerned about letters of support that just talk about the client's good qualities without reflecting awareness of the client's negative factors. So for example, a letter from the client's friend that just talks about how great of a parent the client is, or talks about the client's religious involvement without saying anything about the client's past criminal history. Based on the AAO decisions, they're not going to consider that type of letter to be very effective. And then similarly, if the letter is from a treatment provider who is saying that the client is doing well in treatment, but there is evidence that the client has either relapsed previously or had other issues of compliance with previous treatment. A letter from the treatment provider that just talks about how the client is doing well in treatment without discussing those previous topics will similarly not be as effective. And this is a counseling moment with clients because, of course, it is sensitive. These are sensitive topics to have to be disclosing to people who are writing letters of support for the client. we can explain to our clients that immigration's rule is that letters of support that talk about the good things the client has done, but don't reflect awareness of the more negative things are not going to be as effective, and that it's our job to convince immigration that the client should be able to stay here. And that, you know, given the client's past, there's a possibility that the case could be denied if we have letters that are not as effective. And so we're not forcing our clients to disclose information that is sensitive, but instead as part of the informed consent of making sure clients understand all of the risks involved in different courses of action before they file a petition. Part of that is counseling them about the fact that a letter of support that is not as complete, that doesn't reflect awareness of those factors on the screen, may not be as effective. And then finally, with letters of support, like all pieces of evidence, it's very important that they're, of course, accurate and that they're consistent with other evidence in the record. Because if they're inconsistent with other evidence, that can harm the client's credibility. And when the client has the burden, then that can be an issue. So if they're not completely consistent, then it's important that any inconsistencies are explained with independent evidence. Next slide, please. So this is a slightly different topic. Leah was talking about how in U and invisibility waiver cases, when there are particularly, depending on the nature of the adverse factors, if they're particularly serious, USCIS will only exercise discretion in extraordinary circumstances. And similar to that is the U adjustment regulation, which is 8 CFR 245.24D11. That regulation says that depending on the seriousness of the adverse factors, the client may need to show that denial of adjustment will result in exceptional and extremely unusual hardship. So given these two regulations about U and invisibility waivers, as well as about adjustment, consider whether the very existence of the client's mental health condition means that either denial of adjustment or deportation or both will result in this type of hardship. And similarly, you could argue that any type of mental health hardship that the client would suffer upon deportation is an extraordinary circumstance that means USCIS should exercise discretion favorably. And when you're talking to your client and when you're doing your own research, these are some factors that you can consider in determining whether you can make an argument that, again, the very existence of this condition means that the client will suffer this type of hardship. That first factor, availability of treatment in the home country, is especially relevant and helpful if the client is currently receiving treatment. And when you're thinking about the availability of treatment in the home country, think about both the availability of therapy as well as psychiatric care and access to any medication the client is taking. If the client is receiving treatment in the United States, it would be ideal if there's a statement that's more than just the client saying, I don't think I could access this in the home country, to the extent you can access it, having country conditions evidence about the availability and adequacy of mental health treatment in the home country would be very helpful here. A letter from the client's treatment provider is also critical. If the provider is able to talk about the effect on the client of interruption of treatment, and the provider's ability, or more likely lack thereof, to be able to continue treating the client if the client is outside of the United States is also very helpful and very compelling. Because if there's, you know, if there's a mental health provider saying this client's mental health will, you know, take a nosedive upon deportation, that is really compelling evidence of extreme hardship. And that's really helpful to have in the record, depending on the seriousness of the client's adverse factors. You may also want to consider asylum and withholding of removal cases for your client's home country. Not again, because this is an asylum case, but because if you're able to find any cases where the protected ground that justified the grant of asylum or withholding was the existence of a mental health condition, for the in the client's home country, then you can use that as compelling evidence that, again, deportation to this country for this client who has a mental health condition would be an exceptional and extremely unusual hardship. Similarly, for Convention Against Torture cases for the client's home country, you could see whether there have been any cases where an adjudicator has found that the applicant was more likely than not to be tortured in the home country precisely because they had a mental health condition. And of course, if you can find precedent decisions, that's great. But even if all you can find are non-precedent decisions, that's still really compelling evidence that you can present. And similarly, you can consider, even if the client, you couldn't find any evidence of persecution or torture, if there is evidence that the client would nevertheless be stigmatized in the home country due to having a mental health condition, that is very compelling evidence to submit, especially if the mental health condition came about because of the qualifying crime. And that way you can frame deportation as a continuation of the victimization, which is a very compelling argument to make. Next slide, please. So child welfare system involvement. So why would we need to address this? Why would this be in the record? Potentially, there might, say a client was a survivor of domestic violence by a co-parent, and part of the co-parent's abuse of the client was the abuse of their child in common. So you might have evidence in the record that either demonstrates that the client was abused or demonstrates the substantial abuse, for example, but that evidence might present your client in not the best light. And in that case, you would need to address that up front because the AAO has found that like a finding of neglect and resultant loss of custody is a negative factor. In these cases, similarly to criminal cases where you want to be focusing on programs that the client is participating in that they're not required to participate in, think about whether there's evidence that the client is continuing to help and support their children and to protect them after the support from the child welfare system has ended. So after the programs have ended, after the caseworker has stopped working with the client, you have evidence that they're continuing to help their children, to work with their children, that is very compelling to present. You want to be considering, is the client taking the child to therapy? Is the client making sure that their child's receiving services at school? Are they working with their child at home? This is all very compelling evidence to present. In terms of contextualizing or mitigating child welfare system involvement by pointing to mental health issues, you would use the approach addressed in the previous slide. So first, making that connection between the child welfare system involvement and the mental health condition, and then perhaps most importantly, showing evidence of those three R's and particularly focusing on what the client has done now to improve the situation and to protect their children that may include receiving mental health treatment if the receipt of that mental health treatment has given the client improved coping skills that they can use as protective factors in the future. And then in child welfare system cases, perhaps the most important piece of advice there is if there's negative evidence in the record about the client needs to be prepared to address it. And I say that because there was an AAO case where the mother had been in the child welfare system and there was very compelling evidence that she had done, basically everything she could to protect her children after her involvement in the system. I think even the child welfare caseworkers wrote letters of support for her case, but the AAO still denied it because she did not address the fact that the record said that her children had disclosed abuse to her and that she allegedly did nothing about it. Like she never addressed that negative piece in the record. So in these cases, it is to the extent possible critical for the client to address, as well as talking about everything good they've done to help their children, addressing the negative portions of the record and expressing remorse. Next slide, please. Next slide, please. So very briefly, matter of BZR is a AG decision from this year. It addresses the particularly serious crime bar to asylum and withholding of removal. And that bar applies if the non-citizen, because of their conviction of a particularly serious crime, constitutes a danger to the United States. And this decision is critical because it held that a non-citizen's mental health is relevant to the assessment of whether they are a danger to the community. And that had overruled a BIA decision from 2014 that had held the exact opposite. And there's a very helpful passage in BZR, which is linked in your materials, where the Attorney General said, an example of a non-citizen who might not pose a danger to the community is a non-citizen who had suffered intimate partner violence, was convicted of assaulting their abuser, and there is reliable evidence that shows that their diagnosed PTSD had played a substantial role in the assault. And this is, you know, the type of case that some of our clients might have. And here's the Attorney General of the United States saying that this might be an example of a person who, despite the fact that they undisputably have this conviction, may not actually be a danger to the community of the United States. Next slide, please. So what arguments can we make after BZR? Because of course we recognize that it's not a U visa case. It's about asylum and withholding. But that said, as an AG decision, USCIS does have to follow it. The regulation supporting that is on your screen. It really does underscore that mental health is relevant by holding that mental health is relevant to an assessment of dangerousness. It suggests that a non-citizen's mental health condition should also be relevant to the similar analysis of whether a non-citizen is a public safety risk, which is often considered in these discretionary determinations. There's also a really interesting language in BZR about the fact that the question of whether someone is culpable for criminal activity is distinct from the question of whether they're a danger to the community. And we can make arguments based on this, that similarly, the question of whether someone is culpable for the crime they were convicted of is different than the question of whether they're a public safety risk, which again is considered in these discretionary analyses. And we can argue that USCIS should not be able to simply use the fact that a client was convicted of a crime and say, that means they're a public safety risk without, and instead we should be able to present evidence, mental health evidence, because that is relevant to whether the client is a public safety risk. And then finally, trying to analogize your client's case as much as possible to the example mentioned in BZR. And again, highlighting, you know, the Attorney General has said that this is just the type of case where the person may not actually be a danger to the community, and then making your arguments for why your particular clients, the connection between mental health and the offense and the abuse means that they're not a public safety risk. Next slide, please. So we have here a hypothetical. So I'll give folks a couple minutes to review this, and then please feel free to put your answers to the questions in the chat box. Okay, I see Nilda said show rehabilitation, which is very important. Christina, did you have any thoughts about this?
Hi. I thought actually there was a question in the Q&A that came up earlier about how to treat an offense or a conviction that happens after the grant of a U visa petition, right? I think we typically advise people that there is, it's a matter of discretion for the USCIS to consider whether or not adjustment should be granted, but there does not, it does not, should not trigger an additional ground of inadmissibility at that stage, correct? Am I right, you guys?
Right, I believe yeah. So.
So similarly, in this case, Lou has a DUI. Is it, did Lou receive their DUI before or after the grant of their U visa? It was after the grant of their U visa, right? Mm-hmm. So we would, I think then we would want to address this underlying circumstances of the DUI, the overall experience that Lou has had and Lou's struggle with getting connected to adequate therapy, Lou's consistency in attending their AA meetings in pursuit of their rehabilitation. So I would think about including all of that material as well. And also a statement, as you described, from Lou acknowledging, the behavior that resulted in them being convicted of a DUI, and any remorse, right? Accepting responsibility, acknowledging remorse, and whatever commitments they've made since that conviction, to make improvements to their life so that this doesn't happen again, right? Things like that. A letter from Lou's sponsor is a good idea, although yeah. A lot of AA programs do not, because of the commitment to an anonymity, won't confirm that someone is a member of AA, but certainly an individual can decide on their own if they want to provide that kind of letter.
Mm-hmm. Right, and Kathleen had some great comments too about, in terms of not a criminal ground of inadmissibility, DUI shouldn't also trigger the addiction ground if they're not currently having an addiction. But it does go to negative discretion. So, right. And everyone here has had really great examples. Mm-hmm. All I would contribute is perhaps trying to analogize the incident with the partner, which mm-hmm. unfortunately will probably come up again at the adjustment stage. The AAO loves to say that the U visa and the U adjustment are two different analyses, two different adjudications. I'm trying to analogize that as much as possible to the BZR example. If they could get a letter from their therapist that, explains that connection, I think that would be helpful. In terms of issues that might come up, the AAO, something about DUIs, they just really don't like DUIs. So that's going to be an issue.
Depending on the DUI also, it's not always not a ground of inadmissibility. So
that's true.
DUI usually is not, though. It's true.
Right.
We don't have that. We don't, it doesn't say here that he has some kind of aggravated DUI, but.
Right. But yeah, you're right. In some circumstances, it could be.
Also highlight inadmissibility isn't required at the U adjustment stage. So we're just looking at discretionary factors. Mm-hmm. And so whether it's a ground of inadmissibility is kind of irrelevant since it occurred after the grant of the U. We're now looking at negative factors. But to Kelly's point, mm-hmm. when there's a new negative factor, they do like to dredge up what the negative factors were at the U stage as well. And so really what the examples gave of like positive factors or evidence that Lou can provide to show that it outweighs any negative or assumption of a pattern, or what they also like to say of like creating a victim, which is language they like to go back and say happened.
Great. And then something else that it would maybe be perhaps more the R of the or Noid stage, because sometimes the AAO says that if an incident was, you know, more recent, which I mean, this was semi-recent, it was 3 years ago, that, you know, there has not enough time has passed to be able to say that this person has been rehabilitated. There is this BIA decision that's linked in your materials. It's called Matter of Edwards. And that decision held that rehabilitation, it's not an absolute prerequisite to an exercise of discretion. Instead, that it's one factor to be considered in the exercise of discretion. So we're definitely not saying don't show rehabilitation evidence. You definitely should if you have it. But you could bring up that decision if there's this argument that just not enough time has passed. Admittedly, Edwards, it's an old decision. So it's about this form of relief 212C that mostly doesn't exist anymore. But the USCIS still cites it in the policy manual. And the AAO and USCIS also cite older case about 212C relief, Matter of Marin. So, you know, if they're allowed to cite Matter of Marin, then we can cite Matter of Edwards. So that's just something to keep in mind as well. Next slide, please. So now very briefly, we'll talk about rights of non-citizens with significant mental health issues in removal proceedings. Next slide, please. We're not going to discuss today the framework for competency, which is an issue for removal proceedings. It is covered in Matter of MAM, which is a BIA decision that's linked in your materials, as well as a practice alert on this topic that ASISTA is going to release very shortly. Basically, the issue here is that competency, it's a concern because it affects whether the client is able to have a fair removal proceeding and whether they're able to exercise their statutory rights in proceedings, which are to have a reasonable opportunity to examine evidence against them, to present evidence on their own behalf, and to cross-examine witnesses. And competency is a concern because it may affect a client's ability to exercise those rights that they have been granted by Congress. Under MAM, just very briefly, it has this threshold test for competency and it asks three questions. The first is does they have a rational and factual understanding of the nature and object of the proceedings? Does the client, can they consult with an attorney or representative if there is one? And do they have a reasonable opportunity to examine and present evidence and cross-examine witnesses? The most important piece of advice on this is that it's really important for the practitioner to bring evidence of possible incompetency for a client in removal proceeding to the IJ's attention as soon as possible. And the reason for this is that the IJ only has to assess competency if there's indicia of incompetency in the record. So if you are bringing this up as a possible issue, then there's your indicia of incompetency. Matter of MAM, which again is linked in your materials, specifically contemplates a motion for continuance, both as a way to allow the parties to gather evidence of potential incompetence, as well as a possible safeguard, which the IJ could institute if they find that the client is incompetent. So make the case in your motion for why you think that the client might be considered incompetent under that MAM framework that we just talked about, and specify in the motion also why you need additional time to gather more evidence of possible incompetency. In the motion, again, make sure you're using that MAM framework. Try to analogize to non-citizens who have been found incompetent under the law in your circuit, because there is some circuit law on this issue, as well as the non-citizens in the MAM case. And then there's also another case called MJK, which is also cited in your index of materials. And something important to remember, particularly with survivor-based cases, is that some clients who have PTSD might exhibit some of the behaviors that were the BIA found in MAM could be examples of incompetency. So you could take a look at that case to see what were the behaviors that they were mentioning, but just keep that in mind that PTSD may be a reason that the client could be considered under the standards enunciated by the BIA incompetent, such that the IJ is required to institute safeguards. Because under the BIA rules, if the client has been found incompetent, you should be requesting safeguards and reminding the IJ that they're required to institute them. And then, sorry, go ahead, Christina.
Oh, no, I just wanted to add that in the decision, the MAM decision specifies also that competency is not a static or a permanent state of being, and that IJs may consider, reconsider, you know, the non-citizen's competency at various stages of the removal proceeding. And this means that it can also, it can both be raised at, you know, a later point in the proceeding, or also that the IJ may revise some of the safeguards that they previously put in place. Say, if the client does connect to some kind of supports that allows them to, you know, function a little bit at a higher level than they were at the earlier stage in the proceeding, as far as participating in their case. But I would say that, you know, I don't know if that's happened to anyone here where the judge like revises downward maybe some of the safeguards, but my guess is that once they are adopted, a court will be reluctant to remove them in part because this is a question whether that safeguards, the adequacy of the safeguards is a question that can be reviewed by the Board of Immigration Appeals as a de novo matter, as a matter of law. So I think they most likely, they will probably be unlikely to lift safeguards that they've put in place. But I just wanted to know.
Thanks, it's a really good point. And then in terms of the PTSD issue, there was a BIA, admittedly an unpublished case, but a case from 2020 where they held that an IJ should have conducted a competency hearing for a non-citizen whose attorney suspected that the non-citizen had PTSD. So there is some authority to cite and support, depending on, you know, the nature of your client's symptoms and whether they meet that test that we talked about earlier. But it's just something to keep in mind, especially with PTSD, because it does affect so many survivors of gender-based violence. If the client, you know, has been found incompetent, again, make sure you're requesting the safeguards. There are some examples of safeguards in the MAM decision and other case law. Some examples are waiving the client's appearance at the hearing, requesting administrative closure, filing a motion for continuance, allowing a friend or a family member to appear and to provide information. To assist the judge. So these are just some examples. They're not exclusive. The BIA has said that the examples are not exclusive, but those are just some examples of safeguards that you could request that the IJ institute. And just make sure when you're thinking about which safeguards to request, think about what is necessary for your specific client to be able to exercise those statutory rights in removal proceedings, which are found at the INA section that is cited here. Being able to cross-examine, to present evidence on their own behalf, and to examine evidence against them. So just thinking about those rights and what safeguards are necessary for your particular client to be able to exercise those rights. And again, this was, you know, a very short treatment of this topic, but we do have a practice alert coming out about it relatively soon that we will send out. And if you have any questions, please feel free to contact us for technical assistance. Next slide, please. Before we move on to questions, we just wanted to remind everybody that we have a virtual conference that's coming up next Wednesday and Thursday. September 21st and 22nd, and it's about a refresher course on survivor-based forms of immigration relief. OVW LAV grantees, so Legal Assistance for Victims grantees, can use their LAV funds to register for this conference, and you may attend the conference without prior approval. Other OVW grantees under different grant programs can contact their program specialist for approval information specific to their awards. And I'm going to put in the chat the reference number that you should use when contacting your program specialist to see if you're approved to use OVW training funds for this conference. And then in terms of questions, let's see what we have. We have a question that says, what if a client is arrested and put on a 5150 mental health hold, but no charges result? It's likely to be weighed negatively like a conviction resulting from the mental health issues. I have seen, there's one AAO case where they mentioned a client's behavior, even though it wasn't in the context of a criminal issue, was a negative factor. I think this depends on whether it's in the record or not. If it's in the record, they might consider it to be a negative factor. I would, you know, try to see if you could connect the mental health issue to the abuse and to show, you know, that the client is receiving treatment now for this mental health issue so that it hopefully will not continue to affect the client in the future. Christina or Leah, did you have anything on that?
Yeah, and add, I think we were very focused obviously today on the criminal grounds. I think here also being aware whether this could trigger a health-related ground inadmissibility or whether USCIS mm-hmm. would think it would, if the basis was like harm to self or others. And so just flagging, it might not, you might not think it does, but if it's in the record, USCIS can RFE about this and whether they think that health-related ground has been triggered. Where there weren't charges, it sounds like there was no case, I don't know that it would be a criminal ground necessarily, unless we're worried whatever the underlying issue didn't need a conviction or admission. But I would also wonder if they would push on whether a health-related ground has been triggered.
I agree.
We have a question. If a client has a mental health condition like schizophrenia that previously made them pose a threat to themselves, but the client has been receiving treatment and hasn't posed a risk in over a year, would you still recommend filing an I-192? So let me take a look at the statute there. Okay, let's see. Have a physical or mental disorder and behavior associated with the disorder that has posed a threat to the welfare of the non-citizen, or have had a disorder and a history of behavior which is likely to recur. So off the top of my head, I would say that you should focus on, in terms of inadmissibility, whether to file an I-192, whether this is like the behavior is likely to recur. If the client is receiving treatment, you could argue perhaps that the behavior is not likely to recur. I would also research some case law just to see how the circuits or the BIA or the AAO have interpreted that type of question.
I would also say schizophrenia has such a range of manifestations and that also a lot of stigma attached. So I would consider what, you know, specifically the client is experiencing, has experienced, what kind of threat. And consider also including evidence in, you know, if you do file a waiver or address this in some way, including some evidence that demystifies a bit of what is meant by schizophrenia or whatever condition that they have, so that it's better understood by the adjudicator.
I also say in this instance, I think some practitioners have reported where RFEs on the issue do then request that the petitioner get a medical exam. And so then it might be a finding one that like if there isn't that present threat that they will actually say that there isn't a threat of harm to themselves or others and are working with that medical examiner to put that information. I would maybe though leave that, unless that's a really concern, I would leave that for USCIS to bring up on their own as required, because you know those exams are expensive and it can be difficult to obtain for a variety of reasons, but just flagging that it's possible if USCIS is going to raise this ground, that evidence you would otherwise provide may be insufficient to them, that they want to have that I-693 that says, because that ground does say regulations by the Secretary of Health and consulting, so looking at the statute. Mm-hmm. And so sometimes providing that, where that information isn't saying there are present risk to self or others, has been enough to get that waiver granted too.
Kathleen had asked earlier, did you say, so this is about going back to the criminal discussion earlier in the presentation, did you say that not having been aware of immigration consequences stemming from a guilty plea could be considered a procedural defect to vacate a judgment and not have it be a conviction for immigration purposes? So is that that mere awareness or lack of awareness makes it so it's a substantive or procedural defect? Or is it misadvice or lack of advice by the attorney?
I think this is the part Christina was covering earlier. I think it depends what's available in terms of relief. So I know where there weren't Padilla advisals, that can be a basic ineffective assistance of counsel. You want to attack that it was actually a procedural legal defect. And if that is a basis to then say that this was a procedural legal defect, that the conviction should not stand, then that should not be a conviction for immigration purposes.
Right. Sorry, I was looking for the question. And yeah, I would suggest that if take going this route to have the person be evaluated by a criminal defense attorney who is experienced in filing these kinds of motions, mm-hmm. Who can evaluate the full record and see whether there are additional procedural defects or substantive defects that were not picked up otherwise. But typically, yes, making a plea without having a full understanding of the criminal, of the immigration consequences of the plea, it does constitute a procedural defect sufficient to vacate a judgment. So what will typically happen, and also this could be happen in the sentencing context, but what will typically happen is that the person will replead to a different offense that protects them from immigration consequences.
And I look into even pre-Padilla, I believe I think at least the Second Circuit had held, had holdings about, I believe it was like misrepresentation of immigration consequences by counsel could constitute ineffective assistance. So I would look to see if your circuit has any case law on that, even pre-Padilla. You have another question. Ideally, you'd want to show rehabilitation on the front end, but what if the problematic conduct was recent? Is it okay to try to show responsibility and remorse and then later supplement the waiver to show rehabilitation since the U process is so lengthy? I think that makes a lot of sense to me, especially since, like you pointed out, in this particular case, it might be helpful that the process is lengthy. So I think that sounds like a good approach.
And I would say rehabilitation doesn't have to be limited just to length of time. And right. So there are steps they could take that show rehabilitation, like length of time is helpful, but not the only indicator of whether someone can show that they've rehabilitated themselves. But yes, always find a supplement and good to do so too.
Or, you know, you can assume that you might get an RFE on this too, right? And continue mm-hmm. assembling evidence mm-hmm. of remorse and rehabilitation.
There's a question, how true is the myth that people who are undocumented should not write letters of support for immigration purposes such as VAWAs and U visas? And why shouldn't they write it and what are the consequences? I mean, I think that depends. I mean, I think it's like a risk calculation. I mean, they don't have to say in the letter that they're undocumented. I don't necessarily see a reason why they should have to say that. But the risk is that they are putting their name out there to immigration when perhaps, you know, we don't know their history, but perhaps this person has never had any type of contact with immigration. And now they're putting their name out there, even though they're not saying they're undocumented. They should consider that fact before deciding to write a letter. They should consider, you know, not putting their address or any contact information, although that may diminish sometimes the impact of the letter. But I would say it's a judgment call for that individual non-citizen, whether they want to write a letter.
Yeah. I have not heard of consequence. I think where letters of support other than substance is whether it's clear what their relationship is to the petitioner, mm-hmm. and how they have whatever knowledge they have. And so I know people in more secure status or citizens will like include that information or a copy of their, you know, green card or license or something. I don't know that that's required. I think usually when I've recommended for clients to get those letters is, I mean, most people aren't handwriting letters, but at least if there's a wet signature to make it clear that it's not like my client that's like writing all these letters of support. Mm-hmm. And so I haven't had pushback in that regard. And so if others have heard differently, I think there's just always a risk inherent in submitting information to USCIS, but have not heard, even if they were to identify as undocumented for whatever reason, that USCIS has taken action on that, or that USCIS has dismissed the substance of their letter because of their status, where, you know, they're otherwise credible, mm-hmm. and have that firsthand knowledge.
I will just add that I know we're at time, but that I have encouraged people to provide some form of ID in order to, you know, bolster the credibility of their letters, because I know that, you know, if in combination with other negative, like credibility things that can come up in a particular case, that they might also cite a lack of that.
Also get it notarized and not have to submit the actual ID to USCIS.
Oh, that's true.
That's true. This is a
very
good
idea. Yes.
That's how you get them.
Around.
I want to address quickly the question of like whether it's proper to get a medical exam. I think relating to whether there's a health related ground, I would wait for USCIS to raise that. And so if they're requesting a medical exam because they want that evaluation of a health related ground of inadmissibility, I don't know that I would preemptively have my client do that because of the cost and every other reason. I would wait for USCIS to say, we're saying this ground applies, because there can be arguments to say it doesn't. Again, you don't have to concede. And some people, the argument can be, we don't think this ground applies, but in case you do, here's why you should waive it. And USCIS then can take that opportunity to say, well, we think it does apply, and here's what you need to show.
Mm-hmm. So we are at time. I just wanted to remind everybody to please remember to fill out the evaluation. Annette very helpfully put the link to the evaluation in the chat box. We do read your comments and your evaluations, and we use them to improve our trainings and to inform topics for future training. So please make sure you do that. And if we did not get to your particular question, you can submit, you can contact one of us with your question. Also, for just a reminder for OVW, Legal Assistance for Victims, grantees and subgrantees, as well as STOP subgrantees. If you have case specific questions, and they're, you know, they meet certain criteria, the case is related to or arising from domestic violence, dating violence, sexual assault, or stalking, you do have access to free technical assistance from ACISTA. You can schedule a TA appointment by logging into your account on our website, and a link to our website is in the PowerPoint. And if you don't have an account, you can make one and then schedule a TA appointment that way. Thank you so much, everybody, for participating, and we hope you have a great rest of your day.
Thanks, y'all.